everyone. Just going to show you a few things that B&Q have donated to the channel this year. I've not done the big compost comparison again because I've tested most of the compost, to be honest, but there is a compost to test. I think it's a new one for them, so they asked if I could try it out, which, yeah, I'm fine with that. So I've got a couple of raised beds here. I'll show you them in a minute, but there's a few other things I'm going to try out from as well. So they give me some plant supports, which are just basically like a half circle support. So I've just put two together inside these pots on these tomato plants. These are they're a plum tomato, Roma. Bit of a determinate plant. So I'm going to grow them like a bush. So they're not quite being supported by this as yet, but I should imagine the top will come through and that'll help. But I can always, you know, use the lower support and then put some string around as well. At the moment, I've just got like a little tiny cane at the moment. But I don't mind having a bit of a wobble because they're outside. They need to get a sturdy trunk. So I've got three of these. The compost is a mixture of my own compost and some spent compost. And I've just topped off with some wood chip. So I'm going to be testing out some feed because I've got three of these. Along with some other plants that I've got. I've got some cayenne pepper and some basket of fire chilies and some jalapenos. Which I'll be using to test feed. Because they give me... bottle of Miracle-Gro all-purpose plant food in the liquid form. I've got good old Tomorite, this is the organic version, and then I've also got the all-purpose granular. I've got these three. So what I'm going to try and do is I'm going to try and got three of these tomato plants. I'll probably try one each of them. They're not all the same sort of size, but they're thereabouts. But what I'm not really looking at overall size, I'm looking at plant health, fruit production and problems, things like blossom end rot and that type of thing. So I'll start feeding them as from probably next week, because they're drying out a little bit, so I need to just sort of like add moisture to them just to sort of make sure the whole thing's ready to accept some feed. Otherwise if you pour it in, it'll run straight through. So you know, I could bottom soak them if need be, but yeah, so the idea is to do them to test the feeds. But I've also got the chilies and some of the cayenne peppers in some different composts. I'll probably incorporate some of the feeds into that as well, but we'll have a look at the compost now. Let's push this to one side. Right, so this is just bog standard. It's a bag I already had this. All-purpose, peat-free, Miracle-Gro. Peat-free, I'm still not convinced of it yet, but we've no choice really. And then we've got this, which is Westland Boost. So I should imagine this is peat-free and everything. Yep. But it's for pots and baskets. So looking at it, it looks more like a traditional sort of compost. There is some lumps in it, you know, when you try and sieve it, you know, there's a bit, you know, that doesn't go through. You can either pop that back in the bag and leave it to one side till next year, and it'll carry on breaking down. It's got moisture control on it, so that should be instant, you know, results straight away. So I'm going to be testing the Boost and the Miracle-Gro, some with no feed. And I'm looking for moisture retention, plant health, fruit production. And then I'll obviously feed them as well. But I need to actually test the compost without feed for a while anyway. Because it's always handy to know how long the compost will last before the plant starts to show signs that it's getting hungry. Most composts tend to have about 4 to 6 weeks feed in them. And then you sort of do a weekly or fortnightly feed. Some things that are in heavy fruit production, they do a week feed, you know, once a week. But sometimes I'll alternate between a feed and a liquid seaweed every other week. You know, it'll have one of each. And that's to test all them. And then also I've got some slugs, which are a gardener's nightmare. These are beer traps. You basically put the lid off. Bury these in the ground. You don't have to bury them, you can also put some rocks around or partially bury them just so they don't tip over and blow away. put some beer in. I don't think I have any preference. You have to go out and buy some, you know, top of the range stuff, just some cheap, you know, lager or bitter, any dregs you've got left in the can or anything like that, put that in, because beer does attract slugs. I do like it, there's no disputing that. You pop your lid on, that's all, and then they can crawl in there, have a swig of the beer, and part company in happy way. But you've got to keep, obviously, because it will start to smell after a while, so I'd probably say daily, get yourself some pincers and pick the dead slugs out, and then replenish the beer, you know, every few days or something like that, because it won't be so appetising, you know, when it's full of bodies and it stinks and it's covered in sludge. You could probably sling it in your compost heap, to be honest. You know, slugs will just all rot, everything rots down, doesn't it? Slugs will eat other slugs, all that sort of thing. And they've also given me some of this copper tape. Now, I do believe copper does work, but I'm not sure about a tape, because I think you have to kind of keep it fairly clean. So I thought, how can I test it? So what I'm going to do, I'm going to actually grow some lettuce. I've got some like wallpaper troughs, because they're only quite small, so I'm just going to put like two or three lettuce in or something like that. I'm not bothered about getting them big, it's just to see, because slugs do tend to hammer seedlings, to be honest. So I'm going to put them next to each other in an area, well, this area here in this corner, because this is slug infested area here. Some of them come from the neighbouring garden, because it's about 3 foot high in grass, so they all come from there at night, and then I can come out with a torch and I'll find them all in amongst the grass here. So I'll get two troughs, one with tape on and one without tape, and we'll see what happens with that. The beer trap, you know, I don't really drink that much, so I'll have to, you know, see my sister, because she likes a can or two, and try and get some beer off her, and we'll have a look at that as well. These will all appear in my updates as I go through the rest of the season. I think that covers all this sort of stuff. You know, I don't know how much this copper tape is. It's called Slugs Away. It's 4 meters. So it's quite a bit, you know, but like I said, when I've done the copper in the past, I've had to, you know, keep it clean. But I do have like a copper frame that I had plant pots in that I used to put petunias in a lot. And I had pak choi in there 1 year, and pak choi is known for being hammered by slugs. And this copper frame, I made it years ago or something, but it just kind of fits these pots in, and I never got any damage. I never see any slugs on it or anything like that. So, and it's not clean, it's well oxidized. So I do think, you know, they don't like it. Another thing I found they don't like is sometimes when you mulch the bed in something like shavings, especially if it's got like manure in it, is when it dries out, it becomes prickly. And obviously, because it on a microscopic level, there'll be like loads, you know, on sawdust, there'll be loads of little spiky bits on it. And they don't really, I mean, I'm not saying they won't. They don't have a preference for going across anything that's uncomfortably spiky. And I found that with my Brussels sprouts I did a couple of years ago. I topped it off, I had some manure that was mixed with shavings. It'd been rotted down for, you know, 8 months or something like that, and I never found a single slug in there or any slug damage at all. And the only difference between that bed and any of those was it had this as a mulch on it, just a thin layer, and it was always rough to the touch, you know. And obviously it broke down, it went into the bed, inevitably everything breaks down. But that seemed to work. But, you know, you use what you've got, you know, and hope for the best, because slugs are a bit of a battle amongst other things, but slug is probably one of the worst enemies, especially for seedlings. You know, it takes, you know, 3 or 4 weeks to get them to a certain size, plant them out, one night, lot's gone. So it's a major setback. It's not like you can get that 3 weeks back. Right, so anyway, we'll have a look at these raised beds. There's two sides, I'm just going to set one up. I had a little look at one the other day, and yeah, they're really, really straightforward to put up. So this one is a metre square, and this one underneath is 1.3. I'm not going to set the 1.3 up, because it's set up exactly the same. It doesn't say on the instructions, but there is two ways to set them up at different heights. You know, if you want a deep one, you can have it deep. If you don't, there's a shallow one. So move this big one out of the way. You know, they come with instructions. There's some screws and some other bits of wood, which you can use if you want. I always find instructions can be a bit of a nightmare. So you figure things out. How durable the wood is, I don't know, but it's kind of like, you know, it's probably 15 mil thick, something like that. But it's, you know, they're not massive beds going to be holding loads of stuff. You know, and if you can't afford to fill the bed with compost, just use it as a compost heap for 12 months. Put all your scraps in it and keep it covered with an old bit of carpet or a bit of tarpaulin or something like that, and build it that way. You know, instead of throwing your scraps away, just knock one of these beds up, throw it in, because you do get, to show you, membrane. With each bed, you get some membrane with it, so it's like a pocket. You know, so you can put all your compost and stuff in it. So you could actually put it on flags if you wanted to. Set it up in the summertime or spring. Grow some stuff in it, and then in wintertime, bag all your stuff up, clear the flags and stuff, and then, you know, leave it, and then put it back out again the following year. So it is semi-portable. The bigger ones are obviously a bit more, hold a bit more compost. I mean, I'd probably say to fill one of them, you're probably going to need 500 litres of compost to fill that bed, I'd say. You know, where I'd probably go with something like 200 litres compost, 300 litres topsoil, you know, because compost dries out very quick, especially if it's peat-free. And topsoil, a bit of sand in there, you know, sharp sand, won't go amiss. Sharp sand, sometimes I tend to like put it in a pile somewhere and just run a hose pipe or throw some water on, just to get rid of any, if there's any salts in it or anything like that. It won't do much harm, because it's, when it's mixed in, as long as there's no more than something like 10% sand in it, you're not going to have any problems. So I'll just cut these cable ties. We shall have a look. So it's treated timber, you know, it's not soft grout. There's some bits of wood here that are bigger. These are to create like a grid sort of scenario. So you go two that way, slot that in there, like that, like that. Because a few years ago I did a little series called My Little Garden, and it's kind of the same principle. It's almost like a square foot garden. So if you want to grow quite a few different things, square foot garden is great, you know, because you could little bunches of spring onions, or you could put probably five onions in that, you know, or four garlic or five leek or a strawberry plant or probably a broccoli, you know, you could put some canes in it and do some climbing beans. It's surprising what you can get out of one square foot. So you've got, obviously, I mean, some people, it's great if you've got strawberries or something like that, because you can put a strawberry plant in each one of these, you know, and then you've got a nice strawberry bed. You could probably tower these if you got a bigger one, if you wanted to, you know, put the big one and then, you know, sort of put some bricks or offset it so it's kind of diagonal across it, and then fill obviously the centre with some sort of hardcore or cans or anything like that, because you don't need all that depth. And, or you could fill it with compost or topsoil and grow your deep roots in the middle, and then your leafy stuff around the sides. You know, there's endless possibilities. All right, what we've got here, we've got four narrow bits. And then we've got six of that size. And without going into head scratching instructions, the easy way I can explain it and summarise it is you begin with a thin one and you finish with them. As long as you start with two and end with two, you can't really go wrong. So that's what we'll do. I'll pull two of them out of the way. I think all this is in sort of shot. And we'll start off with two of these. Obviously, flat ground. If you've got someone to help you, great. If you haven't, just plod along. But it's not that difficult, you know. You slot that in there, because you've got these little notches in. Slot that in there. Get another one of these as well. Push that in there. Shove that back. And again, notch in there. Notch in there. Right, so they're all in. So then you've got another one across that way. So it's just working opposites. There's no screws. You know, there are some screws that come with it, for obviously for this square foot frame, should you need them. And then opposite again. So I've just put them last two across that way, so it's opposite that way with them. and like I say, you finish with the other two narrow ones. And there it is. Doesn't need to be dead sturdy, because once you fill it with soil, it's not going anywhere. So that's a good depth. I mean, I think there, that's got to be about 20 centimetres, 8 inch deep, that. So, when you first fill it, I would fill it right to the top. And then, because it's probably quite light, and then water it like crazy, you know, to help force settle it. Or if you've got a fair bit of compost in it, walk on it, you know, but don't hammer it down. You don't want it too compact, but you need it firm enough, otherwise it will dry out really fast. So that's a deeper variant. It doesn't tell you in the instructions, really, that you can do a shallower variant. So if you want to, you know, if you haven't got enough money to get some compost and that, to get, you know, to get the amount that you require, remove two of these deeper ones, like so, and then replace them with these, if you can get it. Because you've got to try and get them on pretty square. There, so that's probably 5 inch deep now. Maybe 6, you know, but that would be deep enough for a lot of things. You know, especially if it's going on ground as well, because bear in mind, you put some anything on this, it'll wick moisture up from down here. But if you don't want to damage the ground underneath, you know, because you could just put cardboard down in there if you wanted to and build it up like the no-dig sort of lasagna. You get these little membrane things which have a little lip coming up on them. You know, so you can staple them if you want. You know, and then what I'd do is I'd put it into the corners, throw a handful of compost in each corner and then along the edges to pin it all out where you need it. And like this bit here, I would fold it over, but if you've got the deeper version, it doesn't matter. Because you just hold it up and keep piling compost and keep pulling it tight. Once it's all full, you know, your bed's good to go. And should you want to use this partition thing, I'd say you could get the other bed and, you know, it could go across sort of that sort of angle, if you know what I mean. You know, but obviously the bottom one would have to be a bigger bed, so I'd go, if you had one of these bigger beds and then put one of these small ones on top, that would work, because it wouldn't hang over the sides here, in case you wanted like an offset sort of tower. That's what the screws are for. You get a few screws. It's just to screw through these, you know, should you require, but you could probably just lay it, because it will fit in a certain way. You know, obviously it'll fall apart because it's not screwed, so I'm not going to push that bit down because it'll probably drop down. But that's the principle there, you know. You know, so you screw these together, see how many screws are there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, there's 8, so. So you've got 2, 4, 6, 8, and that would hold it all, should you require it. You know, screwdriver through there. It doesn't say you need any tools on one bit of the instructions, but then it says you do. So, but yeah, you don't have to use this, you know. I mean, on this one, the thinner, so they could be used as plant supports. You could use these as supports. I mean, the bits of wood, save you buying bits of wood. There's no harm, you know, pushing it in the corner, one in that corner, one in that corner, you know, tie some string across, put yourself a little row of peas at the back here, you know. So you want your tallest crop kind of north or east, so it's not going to cast shadows so much then. You know, you always want all the growing stuff wants to be south or west facing, so any tall crops north and east, and towered down that way. It's like this end, well, if I put this in orientation, because I know where north is, this is north, and then that's obviously south facing, so the sun will go over that way. So if I put tall crops there, it will shadow things. So if I put them this end, it's not going to cause any shadows, but it doesn't really matter too much in the middle of the year, because the sun goes quite high over everything. But as the year progresses, the sun drops lower in the sky. You know, you could put the other two in them corners as well and drape a net over the whole thing, so you can use these. You know, you don't have to use these for the, you know, the square foot necessarily. The bits of wood, save you buying any, you've got the screws, you know, so you can put them there, one screw through top on each one, you know, because obviously the bottoms will be held in because it'll be surrounded by soil, you know, and then just put some string or twine around and use them like that, you know, but yeah, you can put canes in, anything like that, you know, the possibilities are absolutely endless. At the end of the day, you've got a 1 metre raised bed that you can either have 5 inch or 8 inch deep, you know, which 8 inch is ample. I mean, you could put you could put 4 potato plants in there if you wanted to, you know, probably put more in if you wanted to really squeeze it, you know. You could actually probably, you know, if you're putting it on some ground or grass, you'd probably just lay your potatoes on the ground, probably 5, one in the middle, one each end, or first early put 6 in, you know, and then just fill it with compost. If you did that in sort of 1st of April, they'd be out by, you know, mid-June. Pull your spuds out, your compost has a chance to settle, a little bit of feed, put your summer stuff in, your lettuce, you know, the courgette plants, anything like that, peas, beans. And then you've got some quick crops like radish, you can use it for most of the year, you know. And if you've got a polytunnel, you could put a row of these, or one in each corner, and then little beds. Possibilities are endless, you know, they're a good little raised bed. Not sure how much they are, but yeah, it's B&Q, and they're made by Verve. So if you have a look on their website, because they've got different raised beds as well, they've got like ones that are a bit like pallet collars and things like that, there's different options. But if you go into your local B&Q store and ask for these, you know, or if you screenshot, you know, off the video, they'll know what you mean. As I say, I have no idea how much they are, probably about 30, 40 quid, something like that, I think they are. You know, it seems a lot of money, but I mean, you get 5-6 years out of it, you know, probably longer. Like somewhere at my allotment, it'd probably be shorter, because, you know, it'd be up here in water in the winter time. So, but yeah, on a nice sort of garden, you know, if you've got a grass lawn, you think, you know, I want a little flower bed, just one of these stuck in the middle of it, you know, you can have a little tree in the middle with some flowers around it. It's a quick, easy sort of solution without having to get loads of tools. You know, I'll pull that together with no tools, you know, it's that straightforward. So that's it for this little video. It's just so you know, a few things that I've got from B&Q, which obviously some of them I'm going to try season long. I might keep 2 of these smaller beds, 2 of the other ones I might donate to a local school or, you know, someone who needs them. I'm not contemplated yet because, you know, it's like you always come up with ideas, and I need to make sure, you know, if I don't need it, I'll donate it. That's schools or nurseries and things like that. Try and get the young'uns into it. So thanks for watching. Take care. I'll see you again. Bye-bye.